So thank you for joining me today. Alex, you're Managing Director of Whitecode. Could you tell me a little bit about the company?
Yeah, so Whitecode's a building services design consultancy, primarily operating in the London and the South East, but we've had projects across the country. We've got an office in South Africa as well. So we specialise in all parts of M&E design, from one-off houses to large, complex, mixed-use schemes.
What sectors are you most active in at the moment?
I'd say the biggest sector we're in is the mixed-use, large residential, but traditionally that's where we've been focused on our most work. But in the last few years, we've been really expanding in other sectors, healthcare, a lot more in commercial, schools.
So taking into consideration where we are at present, how do we meet the challenge of closing the performance gap that clearly exists?
I think we need data. I think as designers, we crave data. We rely upon standards to provide us information to inform our design. But I think time is changing and capturing data is so easy and then sharing it. And I think if we just take the GLA, the first scheme that I've come across where there's an actual condition on one of our schemes to actually record the performance of the system and report. Now, where will that data go? If that can be shared with us designers, we can inform the next design. You know, we all want to know whether the system we design and the size of, say, the primary equipment is sufficient or over-designed. I think over-design has been, you know, the tradition for designers to just add 20% for luck.
Yeah.
But actually what we want to be doing is turning that on its head and taking the data from our systems and actually saying, well, do I need 1,000 kVA for that development? Is 750? And I think, actually, how can we engineer the systems of tomorrow to be as efficient as they can be today, to try and get the performance that we expect in design, in delivery?
Do you think we've also been guilty in not asking for that data as well? Do you think we've been too focused on finishing a project, and once that project's finished, moving on with the next one without monitoring? I know there's soft landings, but does it go far enough?
Yeah, I think we're all guilty of it. Who wants to look back when we're looking forward? And I think looking back and perform, something that I've done, I've always liked to have connection to a building management system if I can. Can I sit there with confidence and say to a client, well, you could have one less of those, because I've seen it in the last building that I did that's very similar. I think the government's got a role to play in creating data that enables designers to make, and not even designers, even installers, to make informed, better decisions. If we want to engineer the buildings of the future, then capturing the data, sharing it reliably, then informing standards based on that data is the only way of delivering true performance gap closure.
So the question is, should data have a seat at the standards table?
Yes. I mean, how can we truly inform standards without the right data? And I think that as our usage changes, then the data will change, and we need to inform the standards and feed it in to that, change the buildings as they will inevitably evolve.
We do seem to be making buildings more and more complicated. Do you think there's an argument for going back to basics, or is it more about understanding the process and the design and making sure what we're creating is actually fit for that building?
I actually would go the other way around and say that we need to make systems slightly more complex to take the human out of the building, because if we want to drive energy efficiency, then we need to stop the end user leaving the lights on. We've got an electrical infrastructure that is at the moment finite, and we must protect that resource by the use of more complex systems, in my opinion, that enable us to deliver true energy savings.
The ongoing climate crisis is showing that, as a country, we have to invest in green, affordable housing. However, for consumers and homeowners, investing in green technologies is expensive. Can we afford to be green?
People do look at every penny, and some of this technology is very expensive for that initial capital outlay, and that is going to be a barrier to delivering what the government wants to achieve. And I think that we are going to have to provide grants, schemes to get the take up that we need, and to drive the price down of the equipment. We're going to try and deliver where it's difficult, and I think heat pumps is a good example where it's a great technology, hugely efficient, but I think that the capital cost is going to be a barrier.
So we've got a target of 300,000 new homes a year, but we have a 45 million existing properties. The 300,000 target is that achievable?
And then
if that's not achievable, what are we going to do with an existing building stock of 45 million?
I think we forget that 45 million houses are using energy compared to the new build sector. We've got to target new build because we set the standard for what everybody wants to achieve within the existing stock. So it is right to consider zero first. But if we want to truly achieve energy savings, we've got to tackle the existing stock. And playing at it with, you know, the odd change is not really going to drive down energy. Sometimes we need to legislate because then people take the initial capital cost and then, you know, market factors drive that cost down. And I think we are going to need to legislate for a lot more things than we are probably going to be comfortable in doing. When we move house, we've got energy performance certificates. You know, for me, I think it's time to take that grading system and to legislate and to say, actually, this grade of property can't be sold. And at that point, we'll deal with the 45 million.
Do you feel there's sufficient freedom as an MEP designer to fully embrace sustainable design?
I think that most clients have got a handle on compliance. There are some, but not many, who want to deliver true sustainable design. And generally the problem is around ownership. If you don't own that building and you're not that end user and you're not going to pay the bill, then being that sustainable isn't a priority. We've got to think of a way of factoring in whole life cycle costs. The planning teams and everybody's perception of buildings has got to change if we are to truly deliver wholesale sustainability within construction.
So, I mean, a lot of it sounds like, you know, we're still stuck in that silo mentality where we're looking at the design, we're looking at the construction, we're looking at the operation, but we're not looking at it, you know, collectively.
Yeah, it's got to be an entire decision-making process. But, you know, time and time again I hear, but we can't have the heat pumps on the roof because it will change the look of the building because the height will change. And for me, if we're going to deliver sustainability, there must be flexibility around those sustainable decisions within the planning process. Something has got to give, and I think that sustainability has got to get flexibility within that construction process and the planning process being top of the tree.
Do you think we're going to turn off the gas network?
I think we'd be mad to. We've got a great infrastructure there. Yes, it's got a carbon-hungry fuel in it, but we need to find an innovative solution that might deliver true change to our existing housing stock. You know, all of those boilers hanging on the walls that we could switch over, much like we did in the 60s with town gas to natural gas, to deliver a sustainable liquid fuel down our existing gas infrastructure. I think that is going to be much more tenable than telling your neighbour, I'm fitting my heat pump and sorry about the noise when you've got your window open. We need to innovate. We're great innovators in construction and in this country. There is a solution out there for that network that could truly deliver 45 million or so highly sustainable properties.
We just haven't found it yet. But we're probably not that far off. We are a country of innovators.
We are not far away. There's a whole boiler industry there working feverishly to see whether hydrogen is the solution. To deliver what the government is looking for, it won't be one technology. It will be a suite of different approaches. But we've got to remember, there is a lot of gas boilers out there.
Absolutely. Lovely. Thank you very much for your time.
Brilliant. Thank you, David.